Skyboat Media presents Red Angel, Book 2, Raiders, by C.R. Daems. Read by Gabrielle de Cuir. Chapter 1, The Red God Cult. When I entered my second floor office complex at the Naval Intelligence Agency, NIA, Adrian was at his desk as usual. His tan complexion, narrow face, and sharp features made him look intent, but he was an easy person to work with and always willing to help. He looked up from his desk, and his face eased into a smile. He waved. "Hi, Anna. How did it go yesterday?" The only way that idiot could have sped up getting caught would have been to leave his Navy ID at the scene of the crime. He wore a mask and black trench coat, but had his Navy uniform underneath. The clerk recognized his two unimpressive Navy ribbons when the idiot reached for the money and the coat fell open. They were easy to identify, a marksmanship and a cruiser duty ribbon. Only one cruiser, the Hecate, is docked at the space station, so I spent less than 10 minutes in the cruiser's personnel files, identifying all the enlisted personnel with only those two service ribbons. There were only three individuals. It took another 30 minutes to establish two had alibis, which left Seaman Brent Mills, the lone contender for thief of the day. I had the XO search his room, where he found several of the stolen items. They took him off to the brig, and I went home early, I said, as I stored my service laser in my desk drawer and locked it.
Good work. Except now Commodore Stauffer has to find us another case to work on, Adrian said with amusement in his voice. He's been struggling to keep us busy while the Naval Intelligence Agency waits for another high-profile case to surface.
Normally, they would have dissolved the team and reassigned us after we solved the smuggler case, but Admiral Rawls wanted to keep us together for when the next big problem surfaced. The problem was that at the rate we had been solving cases, Commodore Stauffer was having trouble keeping the rest of his section busy.
Maybe he can give us the Red God case, Chris said as she bounced into the office with a smile on her heart-shaped face.
She had become close to me during the smuggler case, like an older sister I could rely on.
They managed to gain access to the Wyndham Medical Research Center and steal the three red-headed krites kept there for Kawaka virus research.
She gave me a hug, ignoring the red-headed krite that was curled around my neck with its head on my shoulder.
Hi, Red, she said to it, releasing me.
I wonder if they know you have one, Anna.
It's a hard secret to keep.
It made the headlines and vids when they discovered red-headed krites could keep the Kawaka virus in check. The hospital tried to keep my name out of it, but the news hounds smelled a prize-winning story. 4-year-old child with a symbiotic krite that keeps the Kawaka virus in check. Since then, neither thieves nor a man who had the virus have had any trouble finding me.
Civilian crimes aren't the NIA's concern, Adrian said as he stood and came to join us. But because Anna has one, Commodore Stauffer may consider it relevant.
Just then, Stauffer strode into the room.
I do, and I've already talked to the Oxac's chief of police. He says he would welcome our involvement.
Stauffer was an average-looking man, perfect for a spook, as he didn't stand out in a group. He was a good superior and didn't try to micromanage his people.
And it might keep you three busy for more than a day or two.
He laughed, but quickly sobered.
Besides, I think this Red God cult poses a danger to Anna.
Chris shook her head. Their antics would be funny if red-headed krites weren't the potential cure for the Kawaka virus. Adrian sighed.
That's actually why they believe the krites are gods, and that it's therefore their duty to free them. Of course, if the red-headed krites were gods, then they wouldn't need help escaping. But little details like that are unlikely to deter zealots.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.